Hello all, I'm Sindhu C. This is the third video lecture on programming in R basics. So in this video lecture, we'll be discussing about few commands with regards to matrices, list, factor, data frames, and also how to read from a file and write to a file. Matrices can be considered as two-dimensional data structure in R, where it can store data of the same kind. If it is a numeric matrix, then it can only hold numbers, rows and columns of numbers. So in order to create a matrix, the syntax is matrix, then you have to give the data dimension 1 and dimension 2. So here this matrix is a keyword using which a matrix is created. So let us first construct a matrix, say matrix A, and I'm going to have 16 numbers in it, and I'm going to construct a 4x4 matrix. Now we can see 4x4 matrix is created. The second argument represents row and the third argument represents column. By default, the value is filled in column wise. First column will be filled first, then the second column, third column, and so on. What data we are putting is numbers in sequence from 1 to 16 with a step of 1. Now we can see that data is filled column wise. If we need to fill the data in row wise order, we have to add an attribute by row and make it as true. Now you can see that I've constructed a matrix B with data 1 to 16. 4 rows and 4 columns, and the data is filled in row wise order. So first row is first filled, then the second row, and so on. Using matrices, we can perform addition, subtraction, and many other operations like this. Now this is A plus B, element by element operation. A minus B, again element by element operation, B minus A. In all these cases, the 1x1 item is performed, we are performing some operation with the 1x1 item of the first matrix and the 1x1 item of the second matrix. So 1 plus 1 is 2, 5 plus 2 is 7, and so on. Similarly, we can perform element by element multiplication. So here you can see that 5 into 2 is 10. This is called element by element multiplication. Similarly, A by B and B by A. All these operations can be performed. Now, we know that we need a variable to the left hand side to store the data. So here you can see that we haven't created any variable to store these data, right? So say for example, C is equal to A plus B. Now we can say that C is a matrix which holds the summation of A plus B. So if you want to trace back the data later on, then you have to put it in a variable. That is very mandatory. Now we know that matrix multiplication is something very different. It is not performed element to element. So how to perform matrix multiplication in R is, give the first matrix name, then use percentage star percentage, and then the second matrix name. So this is how normal matrix multiplication can happen. And we cannot have any spaces between these operators. So if I give a space here, it doesn't work. So we have to put in all the three symbols together to make it work like in matrix multiplication. Next, we look at creating matrices with various other attributes. So let me create a matrix C for which I need the keyword matrix. Say I'm creating with the data 20 and I'm setting how many number of rows to 4, okay, and number of columns to 5. So this is another way of saying that I need 4 number of rows and 5 number of columns. The next is, again I'm creating another matrix. So using vectors, let me put 4 data here. And I want to say that I need some 2 number of rows. And I want to fill the data in row wise order. So see, here the data is filled row wise. So I have 4 data and I want a 2-rowed matrix. So we have 2 rows here. I can also create a matrix with 1 dimension. Say matrix, and I want to 20 data there, and I'm only giving n number of rows. So say 4 rows. Right, I have only mentioned how many number of rows is required for construction of this matrix. So one parameter is also enough. Similarly, you can also create with how many number of columns is required. So if I say I need 4 columns, so here I said that I want to create a matrix with 4 columns. So this is also possible. It is okay if I give only one dimension. Next, say I'm creating a matrix G and the data that I want is 2,7. Okay. Okay, so the data is filled column wise and it has 2 rows. So here I want data to be filled from 5 to 2. Which is in reverse order. So 5, 4, 3, 2, and I need 2 columns. So accordingly, the matrix is constructed. Next, we look at the functions cbind and rbind that comes with matrices. So cbind stands for column bind. So you can see that I have 2 matrices, mat1 and mat2. When they are binded column wise, so first the first matrix will be placed and then adjacent to it the second matrix will be placed. Similarly, R bind stands for row binding, where I have first matrix and the second matrix. So first matrix will be filled row wise and the second matrix will be later on filled row wise. So let us look at an example for C bind. So C bind, say 1 to 4, that will give you 2 columns of data. First column is 1 to 4 and the second column is 1 to 4. This is column binding. This is one matrix, this is another matrix. Now let's see R bind. Right, so it is filled row wise, the first matrix, then the second matrix is filled again in row wise pattern. When we are dealing with R bind and C bind, when we have insufficient data for a particular a row or a column, okay, for a particular matrix, then it uses recycling rule. So let us see with an example. So I have to input two matrices. Say the first matrix is deficit of four numbers. So what happens is, see, 1 to 4 and 1 to 8. The second matrix has 8 elements. The first matrix has only 4 elements. So this 4 elements are again repeated. This is called recycling rule. Okay, so here again, in the second matrix we have 12 elements. In the first matrix we only have 4 elements. So again this 4 is repeated 2 times. It's very important to note that this insufficient data should be in multiples of this excess data should be in multiples of this insufficient number. So 4 and 12, they should be in multiples. That is very important. Now let us see where this bind can be useful. So use of cbind. So I'm going to create one matrix, say index, and I'm going to use this cbind. Now this is the data in my index. I have two columns of data, 1 to 4. Okay, now let me check what is there in A. So this A is a 4 cross 4 matrix. Now what I'm trying to do is, I'm going to make its diagonal elements as 0. Okay, so now you can see that A's diagonal elements are 0. That is because 1, 1, 2, 2, 3, 3, 4, 4. These 4 values I have assigned it as 0. Okay, so this index, it is used as subscript here, because of which I have assigned 0 to it, and based on that these diagonal elements of A are assigned as 0. Okay, this is one way of assigning the diagonal elements of a matrix 0. It's very important to make sure that you're using a square matrix and all that. Next, let us check how to solve an equation of the form AX is equal to B. So we have a function called solve. So for which, first let me create a matrix, matrix 1, and I'm placing 4 items in it and making it a 2 cross 2 matrix, right? And similarly, I'm going to create another data, a 5 to 6. So I have 2 values now, mat 1 and mat 2. Now let me use this solve function. So when the equation is of this form, AX is equal to B, we need to find out what is the value of X. So what we do is, we bring this A to the denominator of the right hand side. So X is equal to B by A. So in other words, X is equal to B into A inverse. So that is what we are trying to do now. So mat 1 comma mat 2. So solve takes 2 parameters. And there is one more way of solving it. So first solve one matrix, and then you can perform matrix multiplication, right? So there are 2 ways of solving it. Now let us look at other functions that go with matrices. First is n row. How many number of rows are present in my A matrix? So that is n row. Similarly, n column. How many number of columns are there in my A matrix? Then in order to find out eigenvalues and eigenvectors, you can use eigen. So eigenvalues and eigenvectors. Similarly, singular value decomposition of a particular matrix, right? Then you can also perform QR decomposition. Similarly, LSFit, there are several other functions. Then T of A is for transpose of A. So let us first see what is there in A, then T of A. That gives you the transpose of A. So 0, 2, 3, 4 is in column, that has now transposed to the row. So whenever we are working with matrices, we should know what kind of dimension is required. So say for example, eigenvalues and eigenvectors, you have to have a square matrix. Similarly, when you are working with multiplication of two matrices, you should know that the column of the first matrix and the row of the second matrix dimension should be the same. Right? So these kind of things we should know in prior before working with this. Now, how to access data in a matrix? So I know this is my A matrix. Now I'm going to retrieve first column and second row. Right? So this is one represents the first row, two represents the second column, which is the fifth value. Similarly, in first row, I want to retrieve two items. Okay. In my first row, I want to retrieve second and the third item. So this is one another option. Similarly, if I want to retrieve the complete first row, I can give this command, the entire first row. And you can also say that I want to retrieve everything apart from the first column. Right? Apart from the first column, everything is retrieved. So these are the few ways of accessing data from a matrix. So next, we look at list. List can hold different kinds of data. Unlike arrays and matrices. So arrays and matrix can only hold similar data, but list can hold different types of data. Say the first entry can be a number, second entry can be a matrix itself, third entry can be a character string, and fourth item can be a list itself, and so on. So now let us create a list. So I'm naming the list as X, and list is a keyword here. Now when I say name is equal to, this name is a named component. Okay, in order to name a component, we are using this. Similarly, so these are all called named components. So you can consider them as attributes. I have some value and it is of the type this attribute. And I can also have a vector of values like this. So now I'm creating a list with name, nationality, age, height, and a set of marks. So this is my X and it has 5 attributes. So these are called named components. Now let me see what are all the names of X. Names of X is nothing but the attributes of that object. I can also retrieve using these names. So what is the name of X, or what is the height of X? Okay, like this I can retrieve. And it is not necessary that I give the full attribute name. I can also abbreviate it. So this is also possible. Even I can just give H because it is starting with H. Okay. Then I can also retrieve the marks. Okay. And apart from that, say I want to retrieve the second mark. Okay. Second mark is 98. Now we can also retrieve data like this. So the first item, okay, or say the fourth item of that list, okay. First item is the name, then nationality, age, and the fourth item is height. So the fourth item's value is 5.5. So these kind of retrieval is also possible. The other way of retrieving is, say I want to retrieve the name. So this is also possible. Using the attribute name, you can retrieve the data. Right? So this is about lists. Next, let's see about data frame. Data frame can be considered as a table in R. Let's see how to create it. So say I am assigning some value to n. So let me create a vector of 3 data. Right? Say it is the name of 3 people, and say let me create the age of the same 3 people, and I just missed a double quotes previously. So yes, so n is equal to name of 3 people, then age is equal to age of 3 people. All these are just vectors. And say weight is equal to, again that is a vector. So I've created 3 vectors. Now I can club the data into a single data frame. So let's see the values already present, n and a and w. So which is basically name, age, and weights. Now I'm going to create a data frame df and data dot frame, and I'm going to club the already present vectors n, a, and w. Now you can see what is present in df. So n, a, and w, right? So you can consider data frame as a table in R. Now let me give some names or column names to this data frame df. So say name, age, and weight. Right. So this names is a function using which I can rewrite the attribute names. Right. See, now name, age, and weight. Now we can also retrieve data using subscripts here. So in this data frame df 1, 1, 1, 1, the data is Ramu. Similarly, so here we are retrieving first and the second row, okay, and everything from the column. Similarly, we can also do it this way. First and the second column and every row, right? First and the second column and everything from the row, right? So you can also retrieve using the attribute name. This is another way of retrieving it attribute wise. Okay, so this can also be used like a regular variable just by using the dollar symbol. Okay, so I'm retrieving the weights. Whatever data is present under the attribute weight, everything will be retrieved. Next is the function head. So head usually gives the top 6 data of any table, but here we only have 3 rows of data, so everything will be retrieved. Similarly, tail will give you the bottom 3 sorry bottom six data, bottom six rows of data. Right, next is summary. Summary, it gives you the consolidated idea of each and every attribute. So this is a character, you can say this is the minimum value is 1 and the maximum value is 6. What is the mean, what is the median if it is numbers, okay? So such a kind of data will be retrieved. One another way of retrieving data from a data frame is you can assign wherever you have this Ramu, so this is a condition check, wherever the name is Ramu, that row of data will be retrieved. So this is a conditional operator. Okay, so that whole row of column of data is retrieved. Okay, yes, we forgot to add a comma here. Yes, so that data frame where the name is Ramu, so that complete row will be retrieved. Okay, everything in the column, all the other columns where the row is attribute name is Ramu, that row alone is retrieved. Next we'll talk about the factors. Okay, factor is a data type in R. So a factor can make a variable as a nominal variable. The factor, it can store the nominal values as a vector of integers in the range between 1 to k, say. This k, it is the number of unique values. And the character strings are mapped to these integers. Now let us see an example where I'm going to create an object gender. So I'm going to put in REP. REP is for repetition, right? So for repeating male, how many number of times you can say, I want to repeat this word male 20 times. Okay, and along with that I'm also going to repeat say female, okay, say 30 times. Okay, now let's see what is present in gender. Okay, so I have 20 times the word male repeated and 30 times the word female repeated. Now let us see what is the summary of gender. Okay, so the gender object has 50 items and the class is of the type character and the mode is also of the type character. Now let me convert it into a factor. Now I'm converting this gender into factor and then I'm going to assign it to gender itself, which is I'm going to convert this gender into a nominal type. Right, now again you can check the summary of gender. So this is, it has two labels, one is female, the other one is male, and 30 times female is repeated and 20 times male is repeated. So internally what will happen is, say male will be assigned with a number, okay, say 1, and female will be assigned with a number 2 or so. Internally some such labeling happens and then R treats this object gender as a nominal variable. Right? Next comes functions. Functions, they have these many components. First is the name of the function, then you have this assignment operator, then this keyword function, then it can take few number of arguments, okay, and then you have the body of the function. So this is a function, then you can access it using f and then open this parenthesis and give the argument value, say 3 or 2 whatever, and close it. That is how you access the function. So this is the syntax of function. Give the name of the function, then the assignment operator, then the keyword function, then the list of arguments that is to be given to this function, and then the body of the function. Now let us see an example. say f is equal to function, say it is taking two arguments x and y, okay, and say the operation that this function will perform is x plus 2 divided by y plus 2. Okay, now I can access this f using say 2, 2. Okay, so what happens is this x and y will take the value 2 and 2, which is 2 plus 2 by 2 plus 2, which is 1, right? So this is how you can create a function and use the function. Okay. Finally, let us talk about reading a file and writing to a file. So before you start using a file, get to know which location you are in. Okay, get the working directory and see what are all the contents of your present working directory. So these are the contents of my present working directory. Okay, now I have intentionally kept a CSV file here so that I can read its data. Okay, so how to read the data? So say I'm creating an object df, okay, and okay, say data, okay, I'm creating a object data, and then I'm using read.table function, and the name is iris.csv. So let us see what is present in my data. See, this much data is present in this iris.csv file. Okay, now there is another way of reading it. Say data 1, I can use read.csv file function, right, and I can mention accessing iris.csv, and let me say I need the header as well from that file, and the value is separated using a comma that I am intentionally mentioning. Now let us see what is present in data 1. Okay. Here also you can see that we have 150 rows of data and it has retrieved the header also. Now in order to know more about it, what you can do is get to know about the structure of data 1. So it says that data 1 is a data frame. It has 150 observations of 6 variables. Variables are these attributes. Okay. So those attributes are ID, sepal length, sepal width, petal width, and species. These are the data available in this data frame, data 1. Okay. Next, as I told you, in my current working directory, there is only one CSV file. Now let us see how to create one. Okay, now I already have data in data 1 and data objects, right? So let me write using this write table function. Okay, what content I'm going to write is whatever is present in data, right, or data 1, and then I'm going to mention to which file I have to write the content. So let me say iris, I'll give a modified name, okay, dot csv. Okay, then I'm mentioning that rows dot name is equal to false and let it be separated by commas, right? Right, now, yeah, earlier I missed this equal to. Okay, so now we have written the data 1 into the new file iris underscore modified. Okay, now let us see if this file is created. Okay, yes, now we have successfully created this file, and whatever data we had in data 1, okay, we have stored it in the new file iris underscore modified, right? So in this lecture, we have discussed few basic functions with respect to matrices, lists factors, data frames, and also reading to a file and writing to a file. So you, as I told you, data frames can be considered as a table where we have n number of rows and n number of columns. Thank you.